Due to our this class will be conducted in hybrid mode or online mode?
Again?
So this class will be conducted in hybrid mode or only online mode?
That depends on you. As far I understood that most of the classes are going on in online mode only, right?
So sir, can we just now come to the hall, in the GBS hall?
I am in the GBS hall.
Okay, sir.
I mean, I already told that to come at least for like, okay, today or not, I have to decide because most of the students I'm seeing 40 plus students are in online mode only. So maybe we will convert it into online mode and as most of the teachers are also teaching in online. So maybe I will do the same. But if the attendance is sufficient here, then I may need to think here hybrid line. Okay. So last class we what we started is basically the 18 electron rule, and out of that basically you are here that how to determine the number of metal bonds. Okay, so now for example is something we can also determine by conveniently from this 18 electron rule. For example, if you now try to calculate for this complex, I make it a little bigger. Yeah. So, what are the lights? Can you switch off the light, please? Switch off the lights. I think T, this T one. What is written T here? Switch off that one. Now, another T is also there. Look at here. वहाँ दिमाग पे कुछ है क्या भाई? कौन आए थे उस टाइम में, फिर से बुलाओ ना. कि इतना नाटक और नहीं कर सकते, ऑनलाइन ही कर देंगे इस पर. Fine. So, first what is written, determine the total valency electron, TVE, okay, of the entire molecule, that is the number of
valency electron for the metals plus the number of electrons from the ligands. Okay, so that is the total number of valency electrons, or that is the number of electrons which will be placed into the frontier orbitals. Let us say it is A, subtract the number from N into 18, where N is the number of metals in the complex, minus A, say it is B, then divided B by 2 will be giving you the number of metal-metal bonds. That is basically what does it mean. For example, you take that cobalt, cobalt also you can take. Let us take first the iron, Fe3CO12. Fe means, as I said last class, group number is. Did you all now know the periodic table by the group? Did you all go through? I told you in the last class. So, one rule of only of this class is that whenever you are running up the class, only you can learn better. Then manganese, magnesium, rhenium, right? Then it was iron, ruthenium, hafnium. Iron, after that, cobalt, rhenium, then nickel, the palladium, platinum, copper, silver, gold, zinc, calcium, mercury. So this is all of the students should know this thing by heart. Like you have to remember this thing. Okay, because it's not like us, it's not a like just a general course for you. You are the academic and then you get the degree on by chemistry by hours, right? So if you won't be able to say the element name also, then this is pretty good. So you have to remember all the groups by its name, and that is because from the group number of the group. So remember, scandium will start from number 3, because before that group 1 and group 2 will be the alkali and alkaline earth metals. Then group 3 starts with the transition metals, right? So scandium, if it is coming from group 3, then what will be the group number for zinc? 12, right? Correct. Fine. So from the group number, directly you don't have to do anything. You just directly know the group number and input that group number, as I said, for that metal. Iron in group number 8, without any without knowing anything, you just can do that. So just remember the group number and put the group number. So 3 into 8 plus 12 into 2, right? 12 is the number of carbonyl, and per carbonyl it donates 2 electron, right? Altogether it will be coming 48, and 18 into 3 it should be then 54 minus 48 is 6. 6 by 2, the 6 extra electrons you need to get through bonding or through any other means. And how you can get that? You can only get by forming the metal-metal bonds. Metal-metal bonds means each of the metal will now donate its electron, and so that it can not only now will have its own electron, but also have the control over the electron of the next metal, right? By that way, metal-metal number will increase the total number of the electron present to 18 into n. Correct? So that means total number of electron you have to get is 54, but you have only 48 electron. So another 6 electron you have to gather by some other means. And how it is that? That is by the metal-metal bonding. So that means 6 metal-metal bonded electrons has to be there. Each bonding electron will be, each bond have how many electron? 2 electron, right? So that that number by 2 will be giving you the number of the bonds, metal-metal bonds. So the 6 by 2 is 3, right? So basically you have 3 metal-metal bonds. And then if it is 3 metal-metal bonds and you have Fe3, it is very easy to arrange the all the irons in a square. In a trigonal equidistant triangular mode, right? Fe. Cobalt you get by this way, TV number is 60, cobalt group number is 9, right? Then 18 into N is 72, minus 60 is 12, divided by 2 is 6. So 6 metal-metal bond must be there. How you can put all the 6 metal-metal bond? 4 cobalt is there, 6 metal-metal bond needed means put them tetrahedrally and join each of them. Easy way. So you can see by this way, it is a tetrahedral orientation. Tetrahedral can be, for example, tetrahedron will be like this, right? This is the thing of metal. Yeah. You know the meaning of this too, right? What is that? Huh? Broken bond is away from you, solid bond is towards you. Now, how do you convert this projection into this projection? Very simple. Now, we are looking actually from the side. Why don't you look from this? Why don't you look from that, just two of the bond at a plane, beaming plane, right? Then these two is at the beaming plane, and now you see, if this along with this you are looking, then the other two bonds are exactly, right? Here I am looking, these two bonds, little away from it, but exactly perpendicular to that. Is it understandable all? Fine. Huh? Thoda jore bolo bhai. Okay, then next is basically now for this complex also do the same thing. Molybdenum group number 6. This will give how many electron? 5 electron, right? So 6 plus 5 is 11, right? So we'll give 2 electron, that means 2 plus 2, right? How many electron together is actually 15, right? 15 into whole 2, right? 15 into 2 is 30. So altogether you are getting 30 electrons. Now, but there are 2 molybdenum, right? So because of that, that means now your n into 2, n into n is from 2, 18 into 2 is 36, minus 36. 6 by 2 is 3. But now only 2 metals are there and 3 bond you have to create. How we can do that? When this will be the case, that number of metals are in fact lesser or fewer than the number of bonds predicted by this rule, only a metal-metal multiple bond. Because this is the only way to, you can get this. Now, that means two molybdenum was there, and three was the number of metal-metal bonds. The only way to put that is to put three bonds between the two molybdenum. Same way for the iron as well. And here in the last case, also the same thing, okay? Yeah, as I said, these are none of these are actually it is not a law, it is a rule.
Or rule means better to say it is an empirical rule.
Empirical rule means experimentally just observable rule, but not a law. Not a law means it is not something that
okay, something varying from it must have a physical significance or chemical significance. It may not be the case. Then only it will be called basically a empirical law or empirical rule. Basically, it is not a law. Basically, okay.
So therefore, that there must be some a number of exceptions. That is what we will now see. Especially useful for the organically complexes. Of chromium, manganese, iron, cobalt, etc. And especially for this, with a
hepta complexes.
Now the exceptions. As last class we already described, the square planar organometallic complexes
will be following the 16 electron rule instead of 18 electron rule. Correct? You remember the reason for it? What was the reason? Square planar complexes. Why it follows 16 electron rule, not the 18 electron rule?
हाँ बोलो
यस मॉलिक्यूलर ऑर्बिटल्स आर एक्चुअली और बेसिकली नॉट द मॉलिक्यूलर ऑर्बिटल्स सो योर
व्हेनेवर यू आर स्पीकिंग योर टर्मिनोलॉजी हैज टू बी वेरी करेक्ट नॉट द मॉलिक्यूलर ऑर्बिटल्स आर एवरीवेयर ओके सो मॉलिक्यूलर
डी जेड स्क्वायर इज नॉट इन्वॉल्वड So dz square is not involved in the geometry.
Yes. So dz square is not actually participating into the bonding, right? Because it is a square planar, and because dz square is not participating into the bonding, that means what will happen in the frontier molecular orbital? Dz square will be acting as a non-bonding orbital only. Correct? And because it will be acting as a non-bonding orbital, so all the bonding schemes will be all be with the orbitals which is having some kind of components along x and y, which is purely z type orbital like dz square cannot participate into the bonding. That means previously there was 9 altogether orbitals. How the number 9 came? Anyone? How the number 9 came?
So 5d, 1s, 3p.
So 5 plus 3 plus 1, right? So altogether 9. Now 4d will be only participating, right? So 4 plus 3 plus 1, altogether 8, right? So 8 into 2 means 16 electron, and that is what being followed. So
Actually, if you don't give a name, that's why it is not a law, it is a rule. So the rule will change according to the situation. So if you just say that, better to put a law in that way that to attain the maximum stability of a coordination or orbitally complex, the frontier bonding orbitals, remember that term. Frontier means the last orbitals or which are participating into the bonding. Frontier bonding orbitals has to be full, right? So frontier bonding orbitals means those orbitals which are actually on the last cell, right? And that, as I said, it will be 9. If it is all three-dimensional, if it is two-dimensional complex, then it will be 8, right? So 8 into 2 or 9 into 2, that has to be followed. And if that is full, then that complex or that orbitally compound is actually completely will be stable. Correct. So this is number one exception. Some of the orbitally complexes of early transition metals does not follow this rule. Okay, that, as I said, when your coordination number will be lesser than 4 or something like that, often this is the case that this rule is not being followed as such. Possible reason for the same is that some of the orbitals of these complexes are too high in electron density, probably. In energy also, and for effective utilization of in bonding of the ligand, mostly are the sigma orbitals. Okay. So basically what it means is basically when you have a lesser number of coordination number, then basically your sigma, some of the orbitals probably are, maybe countable. You can count, but probably they're not accessible, right? Then this rule will not be followed. Then you have to also understand which will be very high in energy, but that is very difficult as such to understand. Because that we will not be knowing by simply treating this thing as a whole. So, that's one of the reasons. Then, some of the high valent D0 complexes have a lower electron count than 18. Okay. Sterically demanding bulky ligands force the complexes to have less than 18 electrons. Then, it fails when the cluster size is also quite large, then also it might fail and not applicable for main group metals. As I said, main group metals or ultimately compounds will not be having this. This rule as such followed. Okay, these are the list for the violation of 18 electron rules. Okay, most important is the Waskal's complex. This is a very important complex, which is a violation, but not actually the violation. Same as the Sklar-Brunner complex, it is, and therefore 16 electron. But cobalt 2C is one of the very important example which violates from this rule. Okay, it is having 19 electron. So according to this rule, cobalt 2C should be immediately be losing the electron. That means oxidized or reduced. Losing the electron means oxidized.
Oxidized.
Yeah, correct. Okay. So
So basically, this is that means the chart
which is like a violation of the 18 electron rule. Then, as I said in the last class, the metal carbonyl carbonyl bonding is always been stabilized by the HOMO will be the
HOMO of the CO is
at the top here, and LUMO of the CO is here. So the sigma bond will now be like this, and pi bond will be like this. So that means in the sigma bond, the electrons will be moving from carbon to metal, and in the pi bond, electron will be moving from metal to pi star of the CO. Correct?
So that will be the scenario, and that is called
synergistic effect, right? Okay. Then next, another one type, for example, do you recognize what is this complex?
Very well-known complex for you.
Zeiss salt. PtCl3 ethylene is the Zeiss salt, right? It's the basically first prepared organometallic compound, correct? So in the Zeiss salt, the forward donation will be from the pi electron, it will be donated to the metal, and the backward donation will be from the to which orbital of the metal? Preferably the dx square minus y square orbital of the metal. For example, you see here,
if this is the x and y axis.
Now, then according to that, then this will be the xy or xz, yz or y, xz or the yz orbital, and that can have the pi back donation to the pi star of the carbon of the CC bond, correct? So that means if this type of bonding has to happen, then platinum has to be also having high electron density, correct? So therefore, for example, electrons are being donated from the pi of the CC bond, and the electrons are being accepted on the pi star of the CC bond. By this way, the synergistic mechanism also works perfectly in the Zeiss complex. And that was the reason why this Zeiss complex, people could successfully isolate the Zeiss complex in the very ancient stage. Or better to say, without much effort, they could prepare that compound. Because otherwise, if it is too difficult, probably that compound would never be prepared, right? People would not be knowing that. But because of this type of synergistic mechanism, it was easy to form the Zeiss complex, and therefore the later on investigation explored the organometallic chemistry as such. So as I said, the hepticity, which was given by the number eta number, right? Eta hold like a atom after the eta. So this chain, if it is longer, then it is called eta, correct?
Is there anything? Think of something.
Not there. Fine. No problem.
So this type of symbol is called eta, and the number to it, assign number to it like this, will be the
number of number of the carbon or the donating sites attached to the metal, right? That last class we also mentioned. Then, for example, eurosin have a eta 8, okay? It's a unique compound. Yeah, next is pi ligands versus hepticity. For example, these are the common hepticities for different unsaturated ligands. Okay, eta 6 benzene means all the six of the benzene, six carbon of the benzene ring will be now bonded to the metal. Okay. And as I said, eta number is the number which will be donated to the metal. Now, change in the hepticity, right? Now, for example, look at this one, ruthenium eta 6 C6H6 plus 2, having 18 electrons. Now, for example, you incorporate 2 electrons into it or reduce it by 2 electrons. So of course the total number of electron on the ruthenium will be now increased from 18 to plus 2, 20. But the 20 it cannot tolerate. What it will do? Very simply, it will do two of the carbon like this. Two of the carbon will be now taken out of the bonding scheme. Or that means will be detached from the metal. So they are basically this previously this benzene, or which can be told as cyclo. How can you say that? Cyclo hexatriene, right? So one of the ene is now out of the bonding, and then by this way, that means altogether here. Two of the site is out of the bonding, and that two is only these two electrons, right? That means now again I can balance the 18 electron just by making two of the carbon out of the bonding, correct? So this is, that means the hepticity of this benzene ring is now changed from 6 to 4. Then here also, for example, in this complex also. Now, if a ligand is also attached, first one is a reduction, here a ligand is getting attached. If that is giving two electrons, that means two of the carbon need to get out of the bonding. So the eta 5 CP is now converted into eta 3 CP, and two of the carbon is now out of the bonding. And then it can regain this like eta 5 scenario by losing one of the CO. Then two another electron is taken out, and then can again the 18 electron can be balanced. Yeah, next is the question of hepticity versus denticity. Denticity is something. What is the difference between the hepticity and denticity? That is the question. Hepticity, yeah, now it is, you see, in the bridging ligand, it will be always, sometimes it will be used like a, should have eta mu will be used, as I said in the last class also. That is indicating the denticity. Okay, eta is indicating the hepticity, mu is indicating the denticity. Denticity refers to the number of atoms of a single ligand that binds to the central metal or central atom in a coordination complex or even the organometallic compound. So, for example, this is a EDTA complex of a metal, right? So, in the EDTA complex, The EDTA is always mu 6 type of complex. That means 6 atoms of the ligand will now be bound to the metal, correct? Then the, here it is a mu 2 type of complex. That means 2 of the atoms of the ligand is now bound to the nickel, correct? Whereas hepticity indicates not only the number of atoms to be bound, but also should be in a continuous mode, continuous fashion, right? It cannot be here is one and after two carbon or three carbon there is another one. Then that is actually a dendricity, not the hepticity, right? Okay. And next is another one symbol, which is called kappa symbol. All of these symbols are needed for this thing. That's why it is you are being taught for the those symbols. Kappa symbol means it is bound, because for example this ligand, in this ligand now if I ask through which it is getting bound, because there is also comes that maybe this is making a heptic bond with the metal, right? But if I say kappa P or kappa 2P means two of the phosphorus is now getting of that the donation property or getting bound. Okay, then it will be called kappa 2P. This is called a symbol kappa. Kappa 2P is then indicates that two of the phosphorus will be the donating site. Okay, if the kappa is used like that, that means already it is mentioning it is an equivalent way to mention that it is a mu 2 of P. So mu is basically an inferior description than kappa. Kappa is kind of a very precisely you will be saying this much number and this much and this is my side of the donation. Okay, but always it is not needed, because for example here people will be saying mu 6, they will not say kappa 2 n kappa 4 o. That is not needed, because here in the case of a PDA complex there are no other ways of bonding, right? If I say that is mu 6, then only that all of the two nitrogen and four oxygen has to bind with the central metal atom, correct? Next is organolytic catalysis. Okay, now we will go a little bit with that. Okay, and next class onwards we will start a particular you have a next class at 9, I think, right? Okay, fine. Okay, when the link will come, I think sir will be taking by online, huh?
Sir, aaj off hai, aaj nahi hoga class, 9 baje wala. Yes sir, aaj ke liye off hai.
Aaj ke liye off hai, acha. तो अच्छा है, मैं थोड़ा कंटिन्यू कर लेंगे क्योंकि थोड़ा सिलेबस मतलब थोड़ा कम हो गया, मतलब मेरा प्रोग्रेस थोड़ा कम हो गया, मैं कंटिन्यू कर लेंगे, ठीक है? ओके, देन बेसिकली आई विल गो स्लो ओनली. या ऑर्गेनोलिटिक कैटालिसिस, सो ऑल ऑफ दीज थिंग्स व्हाटएवर यू लर्न अंटिल नाउ, 18 इलेक्ट्रॉन रूल, कोऑर्डिनेशन, style of the coordination, maybe it is a eta type coordination, maybe it is a hepta type coordination, maybe it is a kappa type coordination. Of course the kappa and your mu are the same, only kappa may be a little better description. But all these things are where it is needed, or why should we, you want to say something? Okay. Why should we basically learn all of these things? Because of the thing that all are will be needed or utilized into the organometallic catalysis.
Then the next question comes, why this organometallic catalysis is something we must read? Or what is the need of it? First of all, we are seeing the organometallic compounds are practically very unstable. So my catalyst itself is unstable. Then what is the fun of it? The fun of it is that you can get a number of reactions which otherwise will be impossible without a organometallic catalyst. One simple example is the formation of plastic. What is plastic? Polyethylene. And the polyethylene, otherwise it will be very difficult to attain if you don't follow the organometallic catalysis route. Correct? So this organometallic catalysis is very, very important for certain reactions, and we will see those reactions. Okay. So plastic, by the way, just as I say, already mentioned, plastic is formed by a catalyst which is called Jiglar-Natta catalyst. Jiglar-Natta catalyst, right? It's a organo-aluminium catalyst. We'll see those things later. Okay. So basically, how the catalysis or mode of action of these metal transition metal complexes in the catalysis is like that. So anyhow, all of these are also transition metal complexes only. Only difference between the organometallics and the transition metal complexes is that here the complexing site is the carbon. The coordination of the reaction partners with the transition metal brings them into close proximity and thus promoting the reaction. Number one step, number two step is that formation of the or activated complex formation, and that will facilitate the nucleophilic attack, and that vacant coordination site will now then be utilized for recycling that reaction, or basically can be a next reagent can be also taken, and further that cycle might continue. Let us see. So basically, this is a very important catalyst which is called hydroformylation catalyst. Hydroformylation catalyst. So from alkene, addition of a formyl group. What is a formyl group? HCO plus. This group is called formyl group. Okay. That formyl group addition is rather quite difficult if you don't follow the organometallic catalysis, or better to say simple coordination catalysis rather will be inferior or rather not that efficient to put a formyl group across a CC double bond. Okay. So basically here is the addition of HCHO, which is what it is named, HCHO, formaldehyde. Okay. So formaldehyde is now split into two parts. One is hydrogen and this is the formyl part, and that's why this reaction is called the formylation reaction. Clear? Now next is basically, this is another one reaction at the bottom. This is not a single reaction, a chain of reaction can happen, which is also called plasticizer. This type of molecules, which are known as the plasticizers, are basically useful for homogeneous dispersion of the plastic when it is melted. So plastics, when, for example, when this dabba has been made, do you think how it was made? It was made by beads of this size. So the plastics will be coming as beads of like these, or spherical or different shape. But then how this one is made a shape of like that, you have to mix these beads with a plasticizer and then heat it up. That will form a highly dispersed liquid. And that plasticizer is something which makes this dispersion homogeneous. And finally, you can get a mold and put it inside the mold, and you finally get this shape. Okay. So this is one of the plasticizers. It is also made by this type of a this organolytic catalysis. Then the detergents and all of these things are also all nowadays are made by organolytic catalysis only. So this person, Otto, is basically one of the pioneers of industrial homogeneous catalysis or industrial organolytic catalysis. So there are few typical organolytic catalysis is there. One is called hydrogenation reaction. Hydrogenation of double bond is very, very essential for oil, edible oil formation, all of these things. Although nowadays this reaction, rather a reverse reaction is being preferred, because nowadays food, edible oils are preferred with unsaturations, correct? But as I said in the last class, initially that was not the case. Initially the oil has to be all saturated because that increases the shelf life. Okay, so initially this type of complexes, PPH3, whole thrice, rhodium complex, complex will be used, which is called Wilkinson catalyst of type 1. This catalyst is known as Wilkinson catalyst of type 1. And as you see, 3 Nobel Prize was given until now based on this organometallic catalysis only. That means so important of this type of catalysis. Then methanol to acetic acid. Methanol plus CO to acetic acid. This is called a process which you probably all heard, which is called industrial Monsanto process. Industrial Monsanto process is the process which is this methanol plus CO2 acetic acid. And acetic acid, as you know, one of the most industrially utilized chemical for food preparation, all of this, it is basically commonly known as the vinegar, right? So this is one thing. Then next is basically olefin polymerization reaction, or olefin oligomerization reaction. This is what is basically formation of the polyalkenes or polyethylenes, right? So plastic formation is one of such kind only. From a ethylene getting a polymerized product of it. Or it can also happen, for example, also this type of reaction is also sometimes nowadays very useful, that if all of the substrates are at a particular duration, then this is called isotactic polymer. But if it is alternating, then it is called syndiotactic, okay, polymer. So isotactic, syndiotactic, this isomerization is also one of the organometallic catalysis reaction on. And if there is a homogeneity, there is no such thing, then it's called additive. Okay? Polymer. So, now what about the heterogeneous catalysis and homogeneous catalysis? Or what is the difference and what is the utilities of it? The back-end coordination site, if it is located at the phase boundary, that means only at the peripheries of a particular surface or on a periphery of a solid, then that will be the heterogeneous catalysis. And if it is tailor-made type, then it will be called homogeneous catalysis. Or in case of heterogeneous catalysis, the catalyst will be in a different physical phase. Maybe it is a solid, on it all the gases are passing through to get it reacted, or the liquid is passing through to get the reaction. So then it will be called a heterogeneous catalysis. That means catalyst will be in a heterogeneous phase than the reactants or the products. But homogeneous catalysis will be, it can be any of the for example, liquid type of catalysis or gaseous. So catalyst also can be gaseous, or catalyst also can be liquid. But your products and your reactants also will be on the same phase, physical phase. Then that will be called a homogeneous type of reaction. Now, what are the advantages and disadvantages of this? If you want a highly pure product, then your homogeneous catalysis is better. Homogeneous catalysis always gives you highly purified products. And then why should we do heterogeneous catalysis? Because in homogeneous catalysis, the separation of the catalyst is difficult. Separation of the catalyst is difficult. Or you need some kind of post-treatment. So after the catalysis, there are some other treatment you need to make the product separated from the catalyst. So that is a disadvantage of the homogeneous catalysis, because how to separate might be by fractional distillation, might be by precipitation of the catalyst, some thing you have to follow. Whereas in heterogeneous catalysis, this is not a problem, because anyhow there is a phase separation of the catalyst as well as the products and the reactants. So the separation is very easy in case of heterogeneous catalyst. Then why we don't follow only heterogeneous? Because the selectivity of heterogeneous catalysis is not that high as the homogeneous catalysis. So that means in homogeneous catalysis, the selectivity is high, but the separation of the catalyst from the products is difficult. Whereas in heterogeneous catalysis, just the reverse. Selectivity is not that high, but the separation is very easy. So that means, depending on of your which type of reaction you want to do and all of these things, you can get an idea, or better to optimize whether you should go for a homogeneous or heterogeneous type of catalysis. Okay. Most important homogeneous catalysis are usually the late transition metals will be utilized for catalysis only. That they are most important homogeneous catalysts. Now, there are in the homogeneous catalysis, which will be now mostly will be describing, few very important steps of the reaction are to be known or are to be discussed here. First example is the oxidative addition of or the reductive elimination. So these are what are these things we are now dealing with. Now we are dealing with homogeneous catalysis, but the homogeneous catalysis is a collection of few of the very well-known steps. Okay, and those steps are something like that. In each of the homogeneous catalysis, these steps will be followed. And so these are kind of ABCDs of the homogeneous catalysis. And we will see this now, what are those ABCDs. So first is A is now basically oxidative addition, and B of the homogeneous catalysis is the reductive elimination. So if the cycle starts, because catalysis means it should always run with the cycle. If the cycle starts with A, cycle has to end at the, remember it, there is also a rule. If the cycle need to start with A, the cycle must finish with B. So that means if the cycle starts with oxidative addition, it, at the end it must go through reductive elimination or the vice versa. Fine. So in the oxidative addition, a metal complex with vacuum coordination size and a relatively low oxidative oxidation state is oxidized by the insertion of the metal into a covalent bond. So that means here the reaction, what will happen? Maybe the reactant is XY. The metal will come and get inserted into the XY, and that will be a process which will be called the oxidative addition. And for the back-end coordination on the metal side is mandatory. The reductive elimination is just the opposite. Two of the ligands on the metal will be joined by a covalent bond, and that will be coming out as the product. That will be called the reductive elimination. Okay. So both the formal oxidation state of the metal and the electron count on the complex will be increased by 2 in case of that oxidative addition. Oxidative addition can also occur with the insertion of a metal into many covalent bonds. For example, here is such example that this is called first, you remember that if it is PPH3 rhodium complex HCl, that was the Wilkinson catalyst number 1. This is the compound which is called the Wilkinson catalyst number 2. So both of the catalysts were designed by Professor Wilkinson only. And in this catalyst, this is a rhodium catalyst. Now, if it can react with the hydrogen molecule to add 2 of the hydride ligand as such. So the number of coordination increases, and as well also the your total valence electron on the metal will also increase. And the metal of course has to be oxidized, because these, even if hydrogen and hydrogen, two hydrogen bonds, that has to be H minus. Who will be giving that electron? Metal will be giving that electron. Okay, that's why metal has to be oxidized. Okay. Then the reductive elimination involves the elimination of the, for example, two of the ligands, two of the methyl ligand, now it will be eliminated as ethane. And the palladium, which was now previously was in the coordination, will now be eliminated as the palladium nanoparticle. Okay. So now, for example, a beautiful demonstration of this thing was created that we, instead of keeping it C's, if we keep it in trans, then what will happen? So such a big ligand was designed for it to maintain the trans geometry of two of the methyls with respect to palladium. Then, at ATPT, you make a set up the reaction, no reaction will happen. The reduction reduces. Reductive elimination will now be prevented. Why so? Because to make this CC bond, there has to be in close proximity. That close proximity is not possible here, because they are in the trans, and that is a planar geometry, right? So that means making the CC bond between these two carbon is now not possible, and that therefore the reaction is happening, right? By this way, this
these are the steps are actually proved. The mechanistic details of the reaction is proved by this. That there was the reactive elimination was happening. Then next is the transmetallation. Transmetallation, that means you can give the number C for it. So C of a organometallic catalyst.
So transmetallation is a general chemical reaction which, for example, Fr and M dash R dash can react to make M R dash and M dash R. One such example is the Nekesi problem. Rx and R dash Zn X, X dash. Okay? So organometallic zinc you are using. So what it will form? Obviously you also we have any Faraday's catalyst physics, and these are the two reactants. Then R and R dash will be coming, and now the zinc will be now coming as a X exists Z. Although this is not a very well like a transmetallation, because here previously metal was with the alkyne, now it is replaced with a halide. Okay? But it's a kind of a transmetallation on. Okay? So at least if we look at the reaction or mechanism of the reaction, then palladium zero first reacting with Rx to form this RPd2X, then the transmetallation is actually happening. Then actually that Pd is now getting this both of the R, and zinc is coming as zinc halide, and then reductive elimination is happening. That R and R dash is actually now reacting, so that palladium is coming out as palladium zero. So whenever this type of reaction will happen, that R and R dash reaction, the metal has to be reduced to neutral stage or lower oxygen states. Okay. So these are basically ABC. Now another one type of reaction is called carbometallation. It's a reaction involving the nucleophilic addition to alkenes or the alkynes of a diverse range of organometallic reagents such as organolithium compounds. Okay, organocopper compounds or the Grignard reagents. So now you see the different type of reactions. As you can see that with this alkyne, now the R double dash M is reacting to form this as the intermediate, and finally with the electrophile you get the final product. So one such example is ethyl lithium is reacting with the triple bond to form. This is the intermediate compound. Then you give this BOR whole thrice, and that replaces the lithium to get this compound, which can further make the reaction and to generate the natural products. Then number four, four is the migratory insertion. The migratory insertion reaction is when a for example here the CO is there, and to that CO now the migratory insertion will happen, that one of the C's type of ligand will now go and getting inserted into it. that is called schizocidal. Then schizoideal ligand is basically getting inserted into this metal C bond. So then this now either it can be going this or it can be going from the other side also. Okay.
But whatever the reaction, whatever the case, finally there will be one of the C's ligand will be getting inserted. Okay.
So in that case, what will happen?
The metal oxidation state will not change, but the overall electron count of the metal will now vary. And that actually is the driving force, because it was 18 electron, now it is 16 electron. So that is now is answer, and therefore it can take another one ligand here to make the 18 electron back. And this CH3 is now the group which can be further transferred, because now that is ready to be getting hydrogenated or something like that, and that will be now transferred to the next reactor. Okay, so that is called migratory insertion reaction. Yeah.
This is just a, you know, like this C is to this one and it is getting inserted. Probably that was the reason. I don't know exactly why the schizoidal it is being.
But probably it is coming from the C's orientation only. Then here is another one, migratory insertion reaction. You can read by yourself. Sorry. Yeah. Next reaction is the
beta hydride elimination. Okay. So, for example, if a ligand is metal with a empty orbital and there is a ligand with a beta hydride, and there is an empty orbital on the metal, then it can take that hydrogen from the ligand to form,
instead of a such like a alkane type of ligand, now an alkene ligand will be attached, and the hydrogen will be attached to the metal. But for that, metal have to have an empty orbital, and that metal also should be capable of metal hydride bonding. Which are the metals which can make the metal hydride bonding? Remember, first transition metals are very poor into the metal hydride bondings. So that means the metal has to be second transition or the third transition metals, not the first transition group series metal can be used for this type of reaction. So key points: there will be no change in the oxidation state, because anyhow, it is like maintaining the same oxygen state, that from a alkyl ligand, it will be now having a hydride and a pi ligand, and again a vacant orbital on the schizoidal group has to be there, and that will be now used for the elimination reaction. Always goes back to this. Yeah. Now, for example, you see,
here is it, beta hydride elimination. Next, it can again go, here it is. Now, from here, now the beta hydride elimination happened to this transition state, right? For four membered cyclic transition state to go back to this, beta hydride elimination product. then if you need to avoid the beta hydride elimination, basically only way to do that, the beta hydride should not be there, beta hydrogen should not be there. Okay, so the these are basically very like as all of these things are all together here. Migratory insertion, beta, like it, coupling, decoupling, all of these things are all summarized here. So the basic cycle of the aromatic catalysis will run by the 16 and 18 electron fashion. That means first initially it will be 18 electron species, then by some beta hydride elimination or somehow it need to go to 16 electron. Then that will take another one ligand, again 18 electron, that will again get inserted or somehow it will react, that will be again 16 electron, that 16 and 18 electron cycle need to continue to continue that cycle as a whole. Okay, and that is basically the organometallic catalysis. Next is one of this like often the ethylene reaction of the ethylene to polyethylene. There are although the Wilkinson catalyst 1, catalyst 2, Ziegler-Natta, all of these things can work perfectly, but usually only Ziegler-Natta is used, not no other reaction is used, only with pure ethylene, because of the fact that ethylene or this type of compounds like tetrafluoroethylene are something which does not allow this 16-18 transition as such. Often that 16, if it is pure ethylene, this forms this kind of stable pi complex, and from that stable pi complex, the sigma complex will not go back as such. Okay, or in case of tetrafluoroethylene, the sigma complex is so strong that the lability to further make the reaction to proceed will be hampered. Okay, and because of that, these two compounds, one is ethylene and second is CF3 whole 4 ethylene is actually are very difficult to react with any of the Wilkinson or any of the other things except Ziegler-Natta catalyst. Okay, this is a like a one complete catalytic cycle. Wilkinson catalyst 1, that is basically first is the 16 electron species taking out one of the PPAs 3, going to 14 electron species. Oxidus, so anyhow, here when it is star kernel, your number will be now not 18, the 16, right? From the 16, now it has to go to 14 to get the further reaction. So therefore, it is now 14 electron species to enter in the catalytic cycle, then the oxidative addition to get into 16. But when it is 16 electron species, then it is obvious that another 2 electron has to be taken because it is a bipyramid. That means participation of the Z orbital is already there. Therefore, it is taking alkene and further making that. So this is the state, is the oxidative addition. Then pi complexation of the alkene. Then your olefin insertion, the one of the hydrides getting inserted into the olefin, and finally the reductive elimination. So all these ABCDs, what you learned in last 15 minutes, are actually completing the whole cycle. Okay, this is about the organometallic catalysis. Now I will slowly start with this organolithium and organo, I think, Grignard. These two I will finish today. Next class or not, this other zinc and all of this thing, maybe 5 minute break. okay? Then I will maybe 40 or 30, half an hour I will continue again, okay? 5 minute break then. Thank you.